Hello everyone, Paolo, Iorv, and welcome to our interview with the Minister for Education, Norma Foley. Minister, we really appreciate that you have taken the time to join us today as part of our CPSMA AGM. It has been an extraordinary and challenging year for everyone in education, for school staff, pupils, parents, boards of management, but also especially for you as Minister for Education. What would you like to share with our members about this past year?
Thank you, Sean, and I'm absolutely delighted to be here and appreciate the invitation. And you're quite correct. This has been an unprecedented year, bringing with it, you know, unprecedented challenges. And what I really would like to express very sincerely today is the sense of enormous gratitude I feel to school leadership and school communities. And I think it's a gratitude that is shared, I think now, by wider society as well. I think if we had been asked 14 months ago, you know, would we have the capacity to be so resilient and so flexible and to adapt so much, I think we would have balked at it. Yes. And but true to form, I think, in the education sector, when challenges come our way, we are resilient and we are flexible, and we do put at the centre the children that we serve. And I think we saw that in an extraordinarily generous manner by school communities the length and breadth of the country. So I would very much so like to acknowledge that and indeed celebrate it, and to say a very sincere thank you for that generosity of heart and spirit.
Absolutely agreed. I think everyone has risen to the occasion in an extraordinary way.
Absolutely.
Now, we have consulted with schools around the country, and there are some issues that have been raised of great concern to all schools, Minister. As we plan for 2021-22, is knowing what supports will be available to schools next year to cope with COVID, as we are assuming that schools will still operate according to their response plans in September. For example, the financial supports to boards for enhanced cleaning, substitute cover for various absences, expanding supply panels perhaps to cover all of the country. When will we know about these supports, Minister?
Yes, well, you're quite correct. Substantial supports were put in place for this past year. In fact, over 650 million of a resource went into the schools, and I think that was a very positive statement of intent, really, from government, but also from society, recognising, as I said earlier, you know, the importance of schools. And with particular measures that I think were especially welcomed by schools included, as you said, for example, the substitution panel. You would be aware that that operated initially as a pilot, but we rolled it out.
My own school was part of the pilot.
Actually. Oh, fantastic, yeah. And well done for that, because in fairness, it was how well they worked in the pilot system that allowed us to have, I suppose, the confidence to enhance them further. Mm-hmm. And it has been particularly successful, and it is my intention that they will continue for next year. And indeed, where there's opportunity to expand them, we will absolutely do that. I know in some areas there could be geographical challenges, but in the main, it is something, an initiative that has worked well, and I would be very keen to hold on to that actually going forward. Other initiatives, I think, that were overdue, actually, I would say, for example, in terms of, we'd say, teaching principals in that, and making available the additional days so that, you know, every teaching principal now had at least one admin day, if you like. And I think that worked spectacularly well. And I know myself from my own experience on the ground that I think that's a measure that was long overdue. And I think it has worked very well also where you had a pool of five schools, we'll say, so that there was a very definite day that the children in particular were aware of, so there was a continuity within the schools, but also to the benefit, I think, of the teacher who was, you know, on the panel, having, you know, a definite or agreed day in each of five schools. So, again, that's an initiative that will continue, and, you know, budgetary constraints beyond 21-22, I would very much so like to see that continuing as well. I think it's an important one. And you specifically referenced then, we'll say, the enhanced cleaning.
Yes.
4 to 6 hours a day and all of that. All of those measures will be in place as we go forward. So, yes, it is my intention that the manner in which the schools were resourced from a COVID point of view, we are still journeying or making our way through COVID.
It is a journey, yes.
It is important that those resources will be there.
Great. I think schools would be relieved to hear that. And indeed, we do appreciate that the department did provide those much needed and supports. Does the department have plans to address the general substitute crisis affecting all schools? We're thinking especially about EPV days this year. teachers, and I want to pay tribute to all teachers. They were limited to just one day for EPV, for instance, this year. There's talk of maybe up to 5 days next year. Do we have plans as such to address the general substitute crisis?
Yeah, again, I suppose in the broadest sense, as I said earlier, you know, the substitution panels have been significant and have contributed very positively. It is important to build on that, of course. We are consistently engaging with the Teaching Council. Mm-hmm. So we have more than 2,300 PME students, we say, who are coming on stream. And the Teaching Council is very conscious of engaging on an ongoing basis with those teachers in terms of making themselves available and have been successful, you know, in this, we say, it's my understanding from the 1st of April even to the 11th of May, almost 400 students, you know, became available to the system. And I think that's a very strong positive. Yes. And we will, you know, continue that going forward. In terms of the days, there is engagement around that, and the engagement will continue to take place because I think there's a strength in engagement and knowing what the issues are on the ground in terms of implementation of those days for the benefit of staff. And just to say that engagement is ongoing and guidelines will issue in relation to it imminently.
Great. If there's one thing I have from my own experience in the past year, it's the wealth of incredible ability that our substitute teachers have. Mm-hmm. I've been bowled over by it right throughout the year. They've stepped in to the situations you've pointed out. 1 day per week in different schools. Yeah. They've come in at a day's notice of time into schools. They've been extraordinary.
Absolutely.
As well as our own staff
who are based in school,
who have turned up, you know, day in, day out.
And I do think, you know, it is very important to acknowledge that. I think there was tremendous, and I've used the word before, generosity, and just, you know, where people just stood up to the plate, really.
Correct.
And it came from all sides, as you said. It came from the school community based within the school, and it also came from, we say, like the substitute panels and all of that.
So, yes.
We are very, very fortunate in the education system to have that determination and that sense of allegiance, if you like, to service within the education
sector. And people
sector.
Of quality.
Indeed.
Yeah. At this time, there's a couple of issues that are particularly troubling schools, and they're just wondering about maybe unequivocal guidance on whether, for instance, they should participate in school tours and summer camps in their schools. Yep. There was some guidance recently about the school tours, but boards are still wondering a little bit as to whether to go ahead with them or not, and also the same applies to summer camps, especially the indoor ones. Is there any further guidance on that?
Well, I think we're still very conscious that we are still within the pandemic and that we're, as we said earlier, journeying through a pandemic. So I think schools need to be very conscious of that. Now, I'm very respectful of the autonomy that rests with the Board of Management.
Right.
I think that's very important. You know, there is, as we've already pointed out, an enormous wealth of talent and wisdom. And, you know, schools, you know, are unique. You know, there's no two schools that are necessarily the exact same. So there must be that degree of autonomy. So
yes.
I absolutely accept that the autonomy in terms of decisions in relation to tours or whatever rests with the school. But what I will say is that, you know, we are in a pandemic. So we are saying to people, really, we're advising that you would be mindful of that. If it is convenient that you can take your students to within walking distance to a beach or whatever, that's fine, or maybe an amenity or an attraction or whatever. But I come from a rural county myself, and I know that that's not always feasible, you
true.
Know. And
yes.
I think we need to look at the broadest picture. So we would be saying, you know, it is best that you would keep children within their class groups in the first instance, within their pods, within their class groups. If it is feasible for them to walk to something, fine, but I think you would have to be very mindful, really, to go beyond that. But there again, I will say that best placed are those who are on the ground in terms of boards of management to make that risk assessment. But I think we're
it's difficult for them, though.
I appreciate that, but I think the experience is there, and I think there must be an acknowledgement that, you know, what will work best in one school in terms of its proximity perhaps to an amenity is not available in another. So you use the experience that you have and the wisdom that you have, and I have every confidence that schools will do that.
And is there any particular guidance on the summer camps as regards indoor ones especially?
Well, again, I suppose just in relation to summer camps, I suppose I would would be remiss of me not to mention the fact that we are very keen that as many schools as possible, for example, would take up the opportunity to avail of the summer provision this year. It is now open to all primary schools, indeed, second level schools as well. And I think that's an extraordinary opportunity for schools, notwithstanding that this has been a challenging year for schools and school leadership and school communities. But it is an opportunity for children with particular challenges, or children, who might be in fear of, experiencing education disadvantage, that they would have an opportunity really to be supported over a short number of weeks there in the summer. So I'd certainly be advocating that if at all possible.
Okay, very good. I suppose the communication systems have been key, really, to the success of handling all aspects of the pandemic in education. There were issues around emails going out to schools on Friday nights, which were not really conducive to well-being. But I think schools would really appreciate one central department portal that all schools could immediately consult in order to stay abreast of all the guidance, the updates, the emails, the circulars. Is that something that the department might look at? Because the reality was that we were all scrambling in those early weeks. And to some extent, we're just wondering which portal to look at in particular now as well. Mm-hmm. Is that something that the department might look at in their review?
Yeah, and just to acknowledge, and I do appreciate the difficulty, that it did pose for schools in terms of, emails arriving at different times. And I have heard that, and I'm aware of that. And I know from my own experience in schools, the email arriving at a particular time or a further questionnaire or whatever, it's the last thing you need at a given time.
Yes.
But I do want to acknowledge that. But I just want to give that a little bit of perspective and say that, in the midst of the pandemic, any guidelines that issued to schools, and then came via email or whatever, there was a hierarchy of working through those guidelines. So, for example, it wasn't just a diktat, if you like, from the Department of Education that we decided to send it out. It was worked through with all of the partners in education individually and then collectively and then signed off. And there were certain, time-conscious situations where, unfortunately, we'd say emails had to go out on a Friday evening or whatever, which I know discommoded schools and particularly school leadership. But I want to say that was, the extraordinary times in which we found ourselves.
I know the HSC had to forward one last Friday, but that was based on the IT attack, as it were.
And there will be, and there were situations like that, whether it was to do with PPE or whatever, there were situations like that. But I am particularly conscious of it. Mm. And I do want to say that, going forward, there's some excellent lessons to be learned really from COVID. And I do want to say that in terms of the communication, it is absolutely my intention that, communications would not go out, on a Friday afternoon or a Friday evening, except, as you have referenced, maybe an extreme emergency.
Yes,
but in terms of the general communication, I want to acknowledge, the work of the Primary Education Forum. And just to say that there is a consultative group now being set up in terms of, best practice and, as I said, lessons we can learn. And particularly in the area of communication, we are currently also reimagining, if you like, the Department of Education website. But that's just one example. Mm. But this subgroup, we say this communication subgroup, will, I believe, be very helpful, where we can hear the issues that are on the ground and we can work collectively. And I look forward to the work that we deliver.
I think as long as there's consultation and listening to all the stakeholders and so on. Will the department devise a well-supported program training of all school staffs for remote teaching, so that there is consistency in schools' approaches to teaching and learning online? I do think that schools and staffs, again, deserve great praise for what they've gone in the past year.
Yeah.
The department have probably been saved quite a bit of money as well in terms of the upskilling that teachers have done. But, there needs to be a coordinated approach that looks into the next 10 to 20 years.
Yeah, and again, I absolutely want to agree, Sean. Schools have been extraordinary. They have reimagined and re-envisaged, I suppose, how to deliver education, and particularly, we'd say, through the digital aspect of, remote teaching and learning. And that, was very much so appreciated, certainly by, I know, the families and children, indeed by the Department of Education. In terms of, the resourcing of digital technology and all of that, there's substantial resourcing being made available to schools in relation to that, you know, a fund of 210 million. In fact, in this past year alone, 100 million was distributed to schools, particularly in relation to ICT. And I think that's a positive. And I have the opportunity, I want to say that the digital strategy that we have is now coming to a conclusion this year, and a new digital strategy will be launched, and we are looking at the opportunity, and I'm inviting as many schools as possible, you know, to consult on that and to really tell us, you know, what their learning was. And
what works, what doesn't work.
And I'm particularly interested, I suppose, I would regard digital technology as a tool. It will never replace the teacher in the classroom.
Minister, my motto in September was, an hour back in the classroom was better than a month online.
100%. And I'm with you there 100%, Sean. But I would like the widest possible engagement. It has gone live, so we're inviting it, you know, everybody who has an opinion on it, parents, family members, school communities, and even those who are challenged by digital technology. I think that's very important. I know in the staff room there are some people who are absolute whizzes altogether when it comes to digital technology. And I don't put myself in that. I would never put myself in the staff room in that cohort. But there are also those who might have, you know, had particular challenges with it. And feel free to share that as well, because we need to build on that. But I also want to say that in terms of, you know, facility being available for training and all of that, there is, of course, the PDST portal, where there are significant resources. And equally so, schools can apply for an advisor to support them with all of that as well. And sometimes those resources are available and maybe they're not very well known. So again, just to remind people I take your point about communication.
That one central portal which would advise in all those areas, I think that could really be a clear way forward there. New and continuing initiatives. Teachers and school staff have worked in some trepidation at times, obviously, since last September. But one thing that they have really enjoyed is getting back to the basics in teaching the fundamentals, literacy and numeracy. And it's been done at a slower pace. It's been done in a way that teachers have enjoyed. Will the department support schools in a measured approach to helping pupils catch up and maybe not overload us with too many initiatives?
Yeah, I appreciate that. I think I would rather, you know, wisely and slow, they stumble that run fast, a great old Shakespearean quote. And I believe that. I would rather we take it at a pace that will be profitable and beneficial at the end rather than, you know, a headlong run. So I understand the value of that. I particularly understand the value of it in the midst of COVID, you know, that we would take things step by step. And I'm very open to doing that. In terms of you specifically reference catch up there, and, you know, numeracy and literacy. Again, I come from that experience myself and how successful numeracy and literacy has been in terms of implementation of a variety of programs, and we need to build on that. And I suppose I would be saying that, you know, there is an opportunity now, I suppose, as you have said, go back to the basics, but there will have to be an opportunity also provided in terms of providing the supports for catch-up. And that's probably the most important thing. So the first step in relation to that, as I've said, is the summer provision. But equally so, you know, that we would look beyond that, currently working on how we can look beyond that for the new school year as well, so that there would be a very clear element of catch-up being made available.
You know, there's such a joy in watching a junior infant come in at 4 to 5 years of age. And I was just in with my deputy principal in senior infants yesterday, and they're reading at the end of senior infants, despite the pandemic. It's the great joy and the great miracle of teaching.
And it's what it's all about.
Yes. Yeah. Now, schools are setting up new special classes, and some of them are currently reporting difficulties accessing the supports that they need, as there must be is with several sections. Is there any prospect of a central point of contact to make that easier?
Yeah, and I have listened to that, and I think that's a fair point. I think we need to streamline things, and just in terms of special education, and that it is a key priority of mine, of Minister Madigan, of the department. One-fifth of our entire budget now is expended on special education, and that is as it should be. But in terms, I am conscious that, you know, there are a number of different avenues that people have to go down, if you like. So I am presently looking at a manner or means to streamline supports for schools, make it more accessible, make it more user-friendly, make it more supportive, at the end of the day. And Yes, and I will be advising in relation to that in the not too distant future. I'm very conscious of that, and I appreciate the feedback that has come in relation to that.
Great.
And we will do all that we can to enhance it and make it better.
That's good to hear for those as well. Finally, and you've mentioned it to some extent already, does the department have any plans to acknowledge the huge efforts of all stakeholders in terms of what they have been dealing with in the COVID crisis? Staffs, parents, pupils, boards, they've all played their part. There needs to be, in my opinion, a return to celebrating the enthusiasm for education and appreciation of all who have worked so hard. I was fortunate enough to visit Finland in the past few years and with the Ministry of Education there. It's a great example of the mutual cooperation and enthusiasm and trust. And can we go there as well? Mm-hmm. Can we have that sense of enthusiasm for education? It's mm-hmm. a wonderful thing to mm-hmm. be involved in education, mm-hmm. to lead children to a new life.
Mm-hmm.
What can we do to celebrate coming through this crisis and to have that enthusiasm for education?
Well, I would have to say I agree with you wholeheartedly. I would have to say that, to be fair, and I think there is an enormous enthusiasm, a renewed enthusiasm, I would say, and support for education outside of the education sector. For example,
yes.
I think wider society were very conscious of the importance. I think it refocused the mind in terms of the importance and the central role that is played by school communities in the provision of education for our children and our young adults. COVID has done that.
Yes.
And I think there is a whole new wellspring of positivity and positive endorsement of the education sector, which we will build on, which is important to build on. I'm very conscious, for example, you referenced boards of management. Boards of management are extraordinarily generous with their time. They're there in a voluntary capacity. I think it's 45 years now that, you know,
since the
And there are significant supports provided by the department, you know, in 2019, just short of 400,000 being made available, again in 2020, those resources being available, and we need to build on that. And we, you know, we need to support where there is generous goodwill. And you were right, it is important going forward to, you know, to focus on the positive, to focus on the energy, I suppose, that, that was manifest throughout COVID-19. But also on the generosity of heart and spirit. And I think society is well appreciative now and well aware of all that's been achieved in the education sector. And I think even in terms of government, there's substantial funding now being put in place to support schools and maybe bring in, as I've referenced earlier, initiatives that perhaps should have been in place prior to this that are in place now. So we continue to build on that. It's a work in progress.
It's a work in progress and to celebrate it all.
Yeah.
I'm going to leave you with a quotation from Taylor Caldwell. Learning should be a joy and full of excitement. It is life's greatest adventure. I wish you all, and I wish you, Minister, every success in life's greatest adventure.
Thank you, John.
And with that, we will now hear to play us out from St. Oliver's National School in Killarney. I hope you enjoy it. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you.